It's a community becoming a group of legislators for a day. Isn't that amazing?
A discussion of town meeting, its past, present, and future, and what it means for Granite Staters now on the state we're in. Hello, welcome to the state we're in. I'm Melanie Plenda. Today we're here to talk about town meeting, its history, its importance, and why it matters, however your town handles it. Here to discuss this unique type of governance are some local experts and government aficionados. We have Rebecca Rule, author of Moved and Seconded, Town Meetings in New Hampshire, Past, Present, and Future. Chris Goodnow, who has served as town moderator in Salem for more than 20 years. And Tina Guilford, a relatively new town and school moderator from Derry. Welcome, everyone.
Thank you.
And I have to say, I'm very excited to be talking about this. I am an official town meeting fangirl nerd, so I'm very excited to talk to you all about this. Rebecca, let's start with you. You set out to write the definitive book on town meeting. Such an undertaking could only be a labor of love. So what is it you love about the institution of town meeting?
Well, I'll say I tried to write the definitive book on town meeting, but it's not possible. It's a very broad and a very deep subject. I love town meeting because it's about community. It's the people of a town coming together on one day and discussing the issues facing their town and making important decisions. It's a community becoming a group of legislators for a day. Isn't that amazing?
Yes. And can you tell us a little bit more about its history in New Hampshire?
Well, the first documented town meeting was held in Exeter. There's a document called the Exeter Combination, and that goes back to the 1600s, shortly after we're now having our 300th anniversaries of a lot of towns, but it goes back almost 400 years. The towns at that time were beginning to form. They were little independent democracies. They were finding a way to be a democracy. They made their own rules, but over time, the rules became more codified and then were turned into laws. But the town meetings that we have today have a lot in common with the town meetings of 200, 300, 400 years ago. The concept is the same.
And Chris, you're a longtime moderator. So for those who are unfamiliar with the job, what does that entail?
Well, it's really two capacities. One is on deliberative session. Salem works under something called Senate Bill 2. So we have a two-step process. One is a deliberative session in which we go over all the items that are going to be or potentially be voted on in March. It's the warrant. And your point, I think, there is elements of it that go back hundreds of years. It is a community coming together, and there's great social aspect to it. I think much less than 200 years ago when, you know, half the town would turn out. Now we get just a minuscule percentage. But the most of my time is spent on the vote itself and the preparation of the March vote or the state and federal elections.
Let's talk about that a little bit. So you've seen, as you were talking about, you've seen both versions of town meeting. The original, a meeting where townsfolk gather, become a legislative body, and decide key issues. And also the newer version in New Hampshire brought about by SB 2, which created deliberative sessions and then a town meeting election. So how would you compare the two versions and what's sort of similar and different about them?
I think procedurally, they're very, very similar and they feel the same. But I think under Senate Bill 2, there were two substantive changes. One is that the threshold for bond votes went from 2/3 to 60% in an SB 2 community. And that is, while it's only a differential of 6.66%, it's a huge differential in terms of the probability of a bond passing. So I think that's been the single biggest element. And I think the second part of it is that unbeknownst to most people, because you have the ability during the deliberative session to amend the warrant, you can have potentially a disproportionate impact on what the voters ultimately vote on election day in March. For whatever reason, I think that the passage of SB2 has reduced the turnout at our deliberative sessions. We have a community of about 30,000 people. At our last deliberative session, at the height, 75 voters were in attendance. So it's really reduced the deliberative aspect of it. But of course, then they turn out about 3,600 or 3,800 people turn out in a March election to vote on the warrant itself. So I think it's diminished the deliberative, but in some ways it has emphasized the March vote itself.
Interesting, because what I'm hearing you say is that a relatively small group of people are having kind of a big impact on the actual function of the town, like the rules of the town, the policies in the town.
Yeah, so somebody could come to a deliberative session in Salem, our first session, and with 50 people and make widespread amendments to the warrant articles that could have a substantive change in terms of amount of appropriations or the projects themselves. Nobody has done that since we've been in SB2 for the last 14 or so years. But I think that's frankly, they just don't know they have the ability to do that. So that has been something that hasn't occurred, but has the ability to occur.
And just following up on that a little bit, so what would you do to encourage more people to come out? What do you think kind of stops them? And what would you do to encourage them to maybe kind of overcome that and come out and weigh in on the process?
You know, so it's a little bit counterintuitive, and I'm not sure the Secretary of State will agree with me on this, but I want people to come out, and I think it's a healthy thing if they do. But I don't in and of itself encourage people to come out. I don't discourage them, of course. But, you know, people are busy. They have their lives, their interests and the like. And you know, I kind of prepare for the meeting and show up and run the meeting for whoever comes. And so I don't per se spend a lot of time publicly advocating for people to come, even though I want them to come.
And Tina, to you, so town meeting happens a little differently in Derry. Can you explain how it works there and why?
So on the school side, we are SB2, so we have a deliberative and the march, just like, you know, Salem is talking about. But on the town side, we are a town council, town manager form of government. So basically we have a charter. And that charter puts the power on our town council. We have 7 town councilors, and they are the ones who make all the decisions. There's no voting on the budget. There's no voting on bonds, none of that kind of stuff in Derry on the town side of things.
And Tina, you've had a bit of a baptism by fire, so to speak. You were elected town moderator in 2020 and school moderator a year later. So what have you seen over the past few years in terms of interest and turnout for town elections?
So I've been working town elections, town, state, federal elections since about 2016. And I have found that on our town, March election, we've gone from in 2015 having a special election that was called for by the voters by petition to actually raise our taxes and having, you know, over 6,000 people vote. To this past March 2021, we had 1,400 voters come in on election day, and we had less than 100 at our deliberative session on February 5th. It's disappointing to see that go down. And then in November 2020 for the president, we had over 18,000 voters. So It's just frustrating because the elections are all the same amount of work, as I'm sure Chris will agree.
Right. And actually, I'll pose the same question to you. I mean, what would you say to folks who maybe have come out in the past or are thinking about coming out, but maybe they're a little nervous, you know, or something stops them? What would you say about town meeting and why it's so important?
To me, it's extremely important. I think everybody kind of likes to forget that town meeting is kind of, it's the people and where a good portion of your property taxes come from. And you know, I see all the complaints, especially on social media in July and December when the tax bills come out. Everyone's so fired up and angry and they don't like their taxes going up. But where are they in March? I mean, these are the people that make these decisions and a very small percentage. I mean, we have right around 20,000 voters. We're a town of 35,000 people, and 1,400 people are making these decisions.
Rebecca, I'll actually pose the same question to you. What would you like the average person to know about town meeting and why it's important?
It's an opportunity to experience a nearly pure form of democracy. It's an opportunity to be a legislator for a day, to go in, sit with your neighbors, talk about the warrant articles, pros and cons, try to persuade each other to take up the other perspective, and then to vote and make a real impact on the town. I mean, there's a lot of power in the town meeting. And with the deliberative, with SB2, the power is spread out a little bit. It is, you know, it's a split town meeting, but there is still the opportunity there to be a big influence in your town, to be a legislator.
And Chris and Tina, this is a particularly challenging time to be involved in any sort of election and town government. There's a lot of misinformation out there about how elections are conducted, their safety and their accuracy. So what would you like your fellow residents to know about these local meetings and elections? And Chris, let's start with you.
So as you indicated, I've been at this for over two decades, and I'm always amazed at the cleanliness, the ethical nature of these elections that are held in Salem and across the state. I think they are, you know, pure democracy and pure above board behavior. And being an insider in the process, I know that to be a fact. And for people that doubt this, the electronic or optical scanners read the ballots. But in the event that there's a recount, then they are hand tallied. And our recounts over the years have shown to be unbelievably close to what the machines read. And there's a little bit different way because you hand count it. You look at voter intent. But in a community where we've had elections with 10,000 votes, the recount will ascertain a difference of one or two votes. So these are unbelievably clean elections and something that we all should be proud of. That being said, the last 24 months, and in particular the last 6 months, have been somewhat disheartening to me in that there are a lot of groups that have come out and made certain claims, and they have, you know, 5% of the data, and they conflate that into a variety of what can only be described as conspiracy theories that just aren't, they have no basis in fact. And I get it in this social media age, and they read stuff, but instead of reaching out and trying to ascertain how our process really works, they're going right to taking actions that could have a very deleterious impact on our elections. An example of that is, as in many communities this spring, Salem has a citizens petition that would require us to hand count all of the ballots after each election. And you know, so that would take us days if we could get enough people. It would take us days. A March election would probably take us 4 or 5 days to report. And the results, I think, would introduce an error rate that is substantively higher than the machine count. Because when you introduce the human element, good, bad, or indifferent, people make mistakes. It's the nature of the beast. And so now the voters of this community are going to vote as to whether we hand count all our results. That will cost tens of thousands of dollars for each election. And it will take us days and days to report. And it will introduce the ability to make it inaccurate, more inaccurate. And so the fact that we're even having to deal with this is a little bit disheartening. You know, if there was the people on this call and the election officials in this state are highly dedicated public servants that are very low compensation or no compensation. And if there were problems in this process, these would be the people that would make an outcry. But there isn't, because we know how ethical it is. And so these conspiracy groups, I'm not going to name them, but they're out there, are operating on irrational with no basis in fact. And having to address it is disheartening, straightforwardly.
How about you? What do you think?
Well, definitely this whole conflation issue, one of the biggest problems that I find is that they go on social media and they read these things that are happening in other states that don't happen in New Hampshire. I just fielded a call yesterday wanting to know where the drop boxes were for the absentee ballot so that they could put observation on them. And you know, I don't want to laugh at anyone, but we don't have drop boxes in New Hampshire. In fact, you either have to mail it or you have to hand deliver it to the town clerk. We don't do drop boxes. We don't have a box out on the street that people can just drop ballots in. I know that's a thing in other states. It's not something we can do here in New Hampshire. And he you know, I understand Chris being extremely upset about that, you know, petition, because it does make it sound like we have something to hide and we don't. They did try also to do that here in Derry, but because of our form of government, they would have to actually follow the signatures in our charter, and they did not rise to that level. But we do have a marijuana question on our ballot. So, I mean, we had all sorts of stuff.
Sure. That's the beauty of town meeting. That's so great. And do you think, Tina, just to follow up, I mean, do you think that this introduction of these sort of things that we're hearing about on a national level, or these questions, or, you know, this mistrust on a national level, seeing that leak into sort of our local elections and politics and communities, do you think that that's sort of deterring people from wanting to be involved, from wanting to run, you know, be a moderator or, you know, volunteer at an election or a polling place or anything like that? What do you think?
Well, I get a lot of these people that they call in, you know, and they ask me these questions and what have you. And I'm always telling them, you can come work the election. Come and work. We can train you to be a ballot clerk, an assistant moderator, a greeter. There are all sorts of things. And then they tell me, no, I'm just going to come and poll watch. And I kind of have to laugh. We technically don't even have poll watchers in New Hampshire. We have observers and challengers. And it's just disheartening, because even when you are welcoming them to come in and observe and actually see what we do and why we do it and the laws that we follow, you know, they turn their back, and I don't understand, and I really don't. I mean, the best way to learn about what we do is to actually come in and volunteer and do the job. And we actually pay our poll workers in Derry. So if they, you know, if they want to come in and be trained and work for even a few hours, I welcome them.
Here's another question for all three of you. What do you think the future of town meeting looks like? And do you expect we'll see further changes and evolution? And Tina, why don't we start with you and then Chris and Rebecca?
Well, I think we are going to experience some sort of change. Like Chris said, there are bills trying to do everything from taking out the machines to all sorts of requirements. There's a bill in Concord to change the way we register our voters. We're going to change and evolve and adapt because that's what we've done for years. I just don't know which way we're going to go. But our town meeting as it sits now, especially with the deliberative session and what have you, and you have 100 people coming, Chris is right. Someday someone is going to co-opt that and bring a group in and be able to make wholesale changes.
About you, what do you think?
So I think this is a moment in time that will come and pass. I think that the people that, you know, the kind of the conspiracy theorists are a very small subset of people, and they are vocal, but they also are aren't representative of the broad majority of the populace. So I am long-term very bullish on the common sense of the vast majority of people that exist in our state. You know, I think we're incredibly lucky. I'm a fiscal conservative, if I have to reveal my bias. And the way New Hampshire taxes people, primarily through a property tax, provides voters with kind of a quick reaction as to how their tax monies are spent. So I'm always amazed at how efficient the Salem, New Hampshire government is. They provide their services in the most efficient manner possible. Just south of me in Salem is Massachusetts. And I have a frequent term called OPM, which is other people's money. And when you're not directly paying the bill, it's easier to spend it. And in New Hampshire, I'm biased. I think we do it right. Is there, do we have high property taxes? Yes. Do we have highly efficient value government? I know we do. I know we do in Salem. So long term, I'm very optimistic. I just view this, what is occurring now, as a moment in time.
Finally, Rebecca, to you, what do you think?
I'm really heartened by what Chris says, but I take the long view of town meeting. I mean, I'm interested in as an example of holding on to our history, holding on to our heritage, and we'll hold on to it as long as we can. Last I knew, little more than 2/3 of the towns in New Hampshire still had traditional town meeting. And these are mainly the smaller towns where it's a little more manageable, and 100 or 200 or 250 people showing up on a Saturday is a great representation of a cross-section of the voters. And that can work, and I think it can continue to work for a long time. And I'm also aware that every town meeting season, there are legal challenges at deliberative sessions and town meetings. What can we do? What can't we do? That's evolving as well. But I hope that these small towns especially will hold on to that tradition of pure democracy for as long as they can.
Rebecca Rule, author of Moved and Seconded, Salem Town Moderator Chris Goodnow, and Derry School and Town Moderator Tina Guilford, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The conversation continues online. Have you been to a town meeting or deliberative session? What do you think? We'd love to hear from you. Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag NHTownMeeting. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.